Welcome, everyone, to Mix with the Masters. I'm Alan Meyerson, again with you for the second edition of Deconstructing a Mix with Me. The first time around, we did something really interesting. We got a piece of music that I had never heard before for a TV show called Man in the High Castle, and we went from scratch and just did it from the beginning to the end. And, you know, this time I thought it would be fun to do something completely different. And so what I have for you today is something that I recorded and mixed for a little unknown movie coming out called Pirates of the Caribbean. This is obviously Pirates of the Caribbean 5. And what I got for you is the end credit theme music, which is basically the iconic theme that has been part of the Pirates franchise since the very beginning. The theme was written by Hans Zimmer, and this realization of it is done by an incredibly talented composer who did this home film named Jeff Zanelli. He was kind enough to let us use this piece of music for this seminar, for this mix. So it's really quite an interesting process this time around. When I mixed this originally, we were running on three different rigs because it's just a massively huge session. I'll go through some of it with you. So this particular session here now, as we've ended up, has 745 voices. Not quite your Chris Lord-Alge pop record, but we do our best. So if I go from the top, we basically have three rigs worth of material in one rig. We have our orchestra passes. So here we have, and I'll go through this in detail with you. We have the main string pass, which is basically the main theme, and I'll play that in a second. Then the samples that go along with that, because as a lot of you that are familiar with this type of music know, we do blend a little bit. And then we have a second string pass, a third string pass, and then the samples that go along with those. And then we begin the brass passes. So this is our first brass pass, which in this case is low brass, which is the trombones and the tubas. And they're requisite samples, which didn't get used very much. And then we have French horns and trumpets, and their requisite samples. And then we have choir. We have male choir, we have female choir. We have the samples of the female choir. We didn't use any of the samples for the male choir. Then we have our VCAs for the non-orchestral elements. I think up here we had the VCAs for the orchestral elements. And now we have the VCAs for the non-orchestral elements there. So now we have, in terms of percussion, there's a tremendous amount of percussion. You know, why don't I play a little of this for you? I won't play you the whole thing because it's long, but I'm going to play you the first part so you can get a sense of what we're talking about. Very cool stuff. We'll get to the end, but I just wanted to give you a little taste of it. We recorded this, the orchestral elements at Sony Studios in Hollywood. And obviously we did the brass and the strings separately, with the woodwinds with the strings. We'll go through those tracks. And then the percussion on this one, unlike the other movies, they wanted something a little bit more kind of aggressive and less grand in the sense of film score type percussion. So I suggested that we go to the Henson Studios, which is the old A&M Studios, which is a room I'm very familiar with. And we recorded the percussion there. And that was a lot of fun. We had three percussionists, M.B. Gordy, who is a film score genius, the great Satnam Mangotra, who is one of the great percussionists I've ever worked with, who is the guy that sort of was the loose cannon in the group and gave it sort of the extra groove that it needed. And then a guy named Mike Shapiro, who tours with my dear, dear mentor and friend Herb Alpert and was in Sergio Mendez's band for 20 years and is one of the greatest drummers and percussionists I've ever worked with, who is just an insane reader. All this had to be read. So for players, this is very challenging. The orchestral players tend to be readers, but the percussionists, you got to get the right breed of players to be able to read. So, and we had to do everything separate. So it was very long days. We had the snares. And again, we're going to go through everything a little bit more, but I'm just giving you a quick rundown. Another pass of toms, rotos. Another pass of toms. And some bass drums, which I ended up using not really to be bass drums, but to be more of an impact instrument. I rolled off a lot of the frequencies. But we'll go through that. So the reason I picked this piece, besides the fact that it's iconic, is, believe it or not, this is one of the smaller sessions we had in the film. So I couldn't rebuild a three Pro Tools rig session to do this seminar. So this was the one that my assistant Forrest, who, if you come, by the way, to Mix with the Masters for my seminar at the end of September, I believe it's September 29th, you'll get to meet Forrest, who'll be coming with me. This was one of the only ones we could get into one rig, and I thought it would be pretty cool to play stuff that everyone knows. So that's for the introduction. We did this in the beginning of the year. The movie comes out May 26th. It's fantastic. It's kind of a throwback to the original two movies, which were so much fun. This movie is a ton of fun. I'm not going to tell you anything about it other than don't be surprised if you see Johnny Depp, because it is a Pirates movie, and somehow or other it wouldn't seem like a Pirates movie without him. We're filming this a little bit before then, but by the time it comes out, you'll be able to watch this. Let's talk about the recording for a little bit. We'll interject some pictures in here so you can see. But the way I set up a room on Sony, which is a nice big stage, this was a very large string and brass group. I don't remember the exact numbers, but I'm going to say it was somewhere around 32 or 34 violins, 16 viola, maybe 8 cellos, maybe 8 basses, and then triple woodwind. So that would be 3 flutes, 3 clarinets, 3 bassoons, and 3 oboes. So that's a pretty large gang. And those guys would all be in a room together. The room is set up in a pretty traditional orchestral, the way I like it, in something like this. Unless the music is written specifically to have an effect that would make me set up the room differently, I tend to set things up in a pretty traditional orchestral way, which is violins on the left, my left, violins first and second, and then violas, and then on the right is the celli, and then the basses behind the celli sort of cheated into the room a tiny bit so that they're not hard right, which I used to do, but are a little bit more towards the center. And then everything is spot mic'd, but the last thing in the world I end up using is the spot mics. I do spot mic'ing, and obviously the room, as most of you who are familiar with orchestral recording knows, we use a decatree configuration, or I use a decatree configuration. So there's, at that height, which on this score was somewhere between 11 and 12 feet, and then there's a next level down, which is sort of my focus mics, which I have at about 8 feet. And I bought a special group of mics for that. It's these Mojave MA-1000s, because they have this sound that is a, it's got a nice exciting electric top end. It's very similar to like an old Telefunken 251, but maintainable. You know, the problem with some of the older mics, they sound fantastic. When you're on a big orchestral session like this, the last thing in the world you can afford to do is have a mic fail. So I tend to use stuff that has the essence of these mics, but that tends to be a little bit more modern so that we have a little bit more reliability. I unfortunately came along a little bit after the opportunity to get some of the more vintage mics was available, and then to get them maintained or rebuilt in a way that made them, you know, really up to a modern spec. You know, because now everything is digital and super quiet, and so with a mic that has a noise floor that is a little higher than others can become a real problem. So we have that mid-height, which is a group of mics like here, and I use these a lot. These are like all of these. These are like my main like juice mics. So if I was, well, let me play the whole section first of all. Nice sound, kind of dry and direct. I mean, this is what this music is. It's very punchy, it's very drivey, it's very percussion driven. It's not John Williams. It's not meant to have that, you know, that gorgeous hall sound. It's meant to be, you know, rock and roll orchestra, which I love. So the top of the room, if you were to listen just to the top of the room, and then we'll talk a little bit about that, sounds like this. Still kind of nice and direct, but it's got a little bit more ambience around it. And then my feature mics would be these guys. Let's give it a nice front end. But as you see, the room is really doing so much of the work. And then we get into the spot miking. And the way I spot mic, if you look at your screenshot, you'll see that on the main orchestral pass, I'm not even using the violin mics or at all. I'm just using a little bit of the violas, the celli, and in this case, usually I use even less than this, but there was a conversation that happened at the beginning of the project that they might want to really go like direct and dry, maybe using a little distortion on some parts. So I used some more spot mics than I normally would. In this case, I had a spot mic, like say for the celli on each, on every two players. Usually I would have every four players and I would never go more than two mics. So if I had more than eight players, that was it. I'd let the room pick up the rest. But if I play you these, all I'm doing is really reinforcing the low end of the room. Because I find that, especially with stuff like this, that what gets lost the fastest is the basses and the celli. So the basses, which are the mics I use the most for this, give me that chunky kind of attitude. Now in this case, because I was using so many mics, I used two different kinds of mics, which is something I don't normally do. And I had two rows. I had eight basses. I had two rows of four. I had a front row of four and a back row of four. So on the front row, I used a mic that I really love on the basses, which is the Sennheiser MKH-800. And I love that mic because it's a really open mic with a great mid-range, but it has this really deep low end. And, you know, the bass players looked at me the first time I put this up and they thought I was nuts. They wanted to see their big U47s or their 87s. And I said, do me a favor. I'm gonna record both of these mics, come into the control room and listen to the two of them. And sure enough, they got what I was saying. But in the back row, I did use the U47s because although they have less bass, they have a really detailed mid-range and a bit of character and color in the sound. And I thought it would be nice to have the combination of the two. So that's what I did with that. On the celli, I honestly don't remember. I could look it up. But again, I think because I used double the amount, oh, I do remember actually. I used ribbon mics on the back. I used the Royer 121s, and on the front, I used, I believe, my Neumann M149s. Then on low, on high strings, cellos and violins, I tend to use Sheps, CMC5s with a cardioid capsule, because I really like the mid-range detail on them. But as you can see, they're hardly in the mix. So the overall picture is really room-based, but it's still got a nice dry direct sound to it. So here's something interesting about this particular project and projects. Actually, I soloed the wrong track for you. That's happening a lot now, is films are getting mixed in Atmos, which is a new format. Basically, you have so many more pathways. I tend to think of it at this point, and there's also a sea change coming in this now, as 11.1, which is basically, if you look at the front of the screen, you imagine there's three speakers behind the screen, and then the left and right speaker on either side of the screen, so there's five, and then there's the sides, which are seven, and then there's stereo surrounds, which are nine, and then there's the ceiling, which are 11.1. So when I record now, a lot of times when I know that they're going to do an Atmos movie, I record it in 11.1. And it's very simple. All I'm really doing is adding some extra microphones. And those microphones are then delegated. They're steered to those additional channels. It's not a big deal the way I do it. It's pretty simple. And the nice thing about it is it crashes down into 5.1 and 7.1 very, very easily. Now, I say that there are things changing because this is changing a little bit. Pro Tools is coming out with a Atmos plugin, and I'm sure that's going to change the way I work, but for now, and certainly the way I did this. So my main tree mics, which I have these M50s, and then my two wides, these are my main mics, and usually on a regular film, they'll go to the left, center, right, front speakers, but the thing I do differently is I take the wides and I send them to the two outside speakers in the Atmos array. So these five microphones are actually covering five different speakers. And it's really cool because you get this really beautiful width. And then when the film goes to final mix, the dubbing mixer doesn't need to cheat and do things with the sound that you don't want him to do. What you're doing actually translates. And then we have the surrounds, which for the purposes of this seminar, everything is coming back in stereo, so they're coming back in the front, as they do in the soundtrack. And it's just a little bit of ambience. And then the height speakers, which have a little bit of distance on them. And then the side speakers. And the reason I like to do it like this is because I'm very, very concerned that the sound would change going from Atmos to going to traditional formats. And I want the integrity of the orchestra to stay the same. So I really focus on this, the orchestral elements, the brass, the strings, sometimes the choir. I'm not so concerned about it with the percussion or the synths or stuff like that. If they want to pan that around, I let them do that. And a lot of times, you know, in the Atmos world, the dubbing mixers will do tricks with the sound. They tend to do that with sound effects more than they tend to do it with music. So I feel like the music needs to create a really solid bed that gives you a nice wrap around, but still focused on the front. You don't want the music to distract from what's going on. You don't want someone to, like, all of a sudden want to look behind them or something like that. Unless there's a specific reason that's been asked for by the director or by the composer. So I try to keep the focus in the front, but give it a nice sense of size and width. And now with Atmos, you can do that even better. So the way that plays back is I have to take that and put that out. What I do, because now, of course, we're mixing in the box, I'm no longer bringing this outside into a traditional format console, digital or analog. Obviously, with 750 tracks, that would be a challenge to find a console big enough to handle it. So the good news is Pro Tools sounds pretty damn good in the box now.